So visual SVN sir, which will be our subversion server for the discussion on subversion, can be downloaded from visualsvn.com. You can download it and you can, it's an exe, so go ahead and install it. Just in case, if you are getting any port already in use problem with the port 4433 or 4443, so go ahead and change the port and install on a different port. It's a simple installation and should not take you more than a minute. Similarly, the client, UI client, which we will use for which we will use for SVN discussion is Tarprice SVN, the most widely used GUI client for Tarprice. It can also be downloaded from the Tarprice SVN website. So based on your type of operating system, you go ahead and install respective client in your system. Again, it's an exe, so installing it should be fairly straightforward. It may ask for restart of the system. Please don't restart it, because again you need to connect to meeting. Probably after the session you can restart. If you have installed Visual SVN Server correctly in your program list, you will have Visual SVN Server Manager. So just click on that. Now, the first thing, after you install Visual SVN Server and open the Visual SVN Server Manager, is to work with SVN Server. So what are the various things that you are expected to do? First, you need to create a repository. First, you need to create a repository, create some users and create some permissions. How do you create a repository? You have a repository section here. It's a site. So how do you create a repository? Create new repository. Give it some name. That's 24 for me. So give any repository name. And here you find a structure. Create default structure. Trunk, branches, tags. Okay. This is the default structure. Now what is it? Why is it? How does it matter? What is the significance of this? All these things please park away. But right now what I would recommend is tick this checkbox when you are creating a repository. Details on this. This is one of the most important thing in subversion, which you will learn probably up in the session 2. So at this stage, just tick this checkbox and proceed. So you have created a repository now. Now, once you have a repository, see that the default structure is also created. Now go ahead and add some users. You can also do it from here. You can also create a user from here. There's a couple of users already for me, but for you I am just showing it again. Create user, I would say mail admin 5. So once you have up for you, the first thing that you need to do is create a repository and then create some users and assign these users having permissions to the repository. That is your first goal. So how do you create a repository? Right click, create new repository, give a name for the repository, and here you would see a default structure. Just check that checkbox, create default structure. I will explain this to you later. Click on OK. This will create a new repository for you. As you can see here. Now, once you do this, create a user. Say SVN user 25. Or SVN admin, anything you can give. You can give any, give him some password and confirm it. Now you have given successfully, you have created a user and you have created a repository. Now for this repository, you attach that user. Go to properties of this particular repository, right click and you will get the properties. See here, you just go ahead and add this guy. You will get the list of people here. You can say SVN user 25. I will add myself also. Added. Read and write permissions. Yes. Apply. Okay. So what we have done successfully now is that we have created a repository, and then we have created some users, and I have assigned the users to the with read and write permissions to work with the repository. That is what I have done so far with SVN server. Generally with server, this is the first thing that you need to do. Create a repository, attach users to it. If needed, create some users and attach the users to the on any SVN tool will be around 3 lines. One, with this SVN tool, how do I manage effective team collaboration? With this SVN tool, how can I do effective change analysis? 3, with this SVN tool, how can I do better release management? So these are 3 things that we will learn with Sarkarshan in this particular course. So before we go, first let's outline our goal. Our goal is to understand how does Subversion enable effective team collaboration. Forget about Subversion also for a while. First let's try to, you know, understand how does you achieve team collaboration first. Forget about Subversion. The goal is very simple. There are people in US and India, offshore and on-site model, working on the same project, and they need to coordinate effectively. They need to coordinate effectively and ensure that one does not overwrite each other's work. That is the goal at a high level. So what kind of solution do you propose if you want to achieve that? If you are not doing it properly, the problem is that there are two users, Harry and Sally. One is in US and one is in India. So both are referring to the same project. They have read the file. Now they have modified the file in their own way. And Harry has written first. So the contents of file are changed at the server. Now Sally has written back what she did, and the contents of Harry are accidentally overwritten. So this is the problem which will come in real time when you don't have any configuration management tool in place. So let's, even though it be rough, try to understand, you know, one way of how can we achieve this streamlining between two users. That solution which I can propose at the beginning is called lock, modify and unlock. So what is this lock, modify, unlock? Okay, in this model, if Harry wants to read, okay, Harry will request a lock on the file. So Harry is given the lock because he is the first person who is requesting a lock. After that, Harry reads it. Now Harry is modifying it now. Meanwhile, Sally also requested a lock. Sally's request is rejected, and Sally is in waiting state. Now Harry completes his work, writes back to repository, and requests unlock, which is granted, and his lock is released. Now Sally's request for lock will succeed, and Sally will continue to read, and Sally will make her changes and sends them back to repository. In this way, you can achieve the goal of, you know, at a given point of time, only one person can read the contents of repository and send the changes back, so that multiple people can't modify the same file at a time. This is one way to achieve the goal of, you know, ensuring each other's work is retained. This is called lock, modify and unlock. The solution is called lock, modify and unlock. But do you see any big problems with this kind of model? There are a couple of important problems which come in this. Just imagine Harry has locked this file for reading and modification, and he left for vacation. So how does anybody else work? So you'd be in continuous waiting state, or you need to contact some administrator and ask him to release lock. But when you are releasing lock, you don't know if his work is lost or not. So still there will be some uncertainty surrounding his work. We don't know if he has placed his cutent or not. His work will be lost otherwise. So it is difficult. Also, another important point is, when Harry wants to modify the first part of the file, when Sally wants to modify the second part of the file, why do you want to wait for each other? Both should be able to do it seamlessly, right? So with locking, what it is introducing is, one, it introduces administrative overhead. Somebody else should be an administrator who should ensure when things are locked for long, we should release the lock and take care of it. Two, it is introducing unwanted serialization, right? I want to modify the first line and Sally wants to modify the last line. Now why should we wait for each other for long? This is unwanted serialization. So these are a couple of things which drive us away from the solution into a solution proposed by Subversion. So how does Subversion propose solution for this? Now let's go ahead and understand what solution proposes for achieving this collaboration. This discussion is the central point of Subversion, so let's try to understand. What Subversion proposes is the concept of copy, modify, merge. The solution proposed by Subversion is copy, modify and merge. So how does this model work? Harry and Sally are two people. Now both are of the same project. Harry is in US and Sally is from India. So both wanted to work. So both have read the file. Say at 10 a.m. today, both have read the file. Subversion allows them to read. That is no problem. One read at 10 o'clock, another one read at 11 o'clock. Both have read the file. Things are okay. Now both are working on their task. One may be working on a bug fixing a bug. One may be working on a new task. Both of them are working on the file. They can work. There is no problem with Subversion at this point. Now one of them gets an opportunity to complete his work and sends it back to repository. So Sally has done her work and sent it back to repository. So what it means is, whenever a file is modified in the repository state changes. The repository says that this file is read again. This file is read newly. So if repository changes its state whenever any modification is done. Now without this knowledge, Harry will try to write to the file. But Subversion rejects him, saying this file is modified after you have read. And it says that your file is out of date. After you have read from me, Sally has modified this file. So the file which is in your hand is outdated one. So what Subversion asks him is this. Asks him to read again. What Subversion says to him is to read again. You have read the file, that's okay. But after you have read, somebody else modified that file. So you better read again. That is what Subversion says to him. So when he reads again, you see that his change is A dash. And when he tried to write, Subversion stopped him, saying, this file in your hand is outdated because after you read it, somebody else modified that. So you have to read again, then only your file will be latest. So when he reads again, the change from Sally is also into his system now. So in his system, the change done by him A dash is here. The change done by Sally A double dash is here. Okay, this is called merge. This is called merge. So which is nothing but A star. So now he will write the A star back to the repository. He write A star back to the repository. So next time when Sally wants to read, she will be getting A star from the repository. So I will repeat again so that you will understand it better. See, the solution proposed by Subversion is copy, modify and merge. So when any number of users can read the contents of repository, this is called copy. You can take a copy of this, copy of your code into your system. Okay, the contents in the server is referred as repository. The contents in the local system is called local working copy. These are two words. One is repository, another one is the working copy. So you should understand these two words. One is repository, another one is working copy. So from repository, you can create any number of copies. Anybody can read from repository. It has no issue. Then you can go ahead make your modifications. This is called modify. First is called copy, second is called modify. So if you are the first person who are writing to repository, you are allowed. Nobody will stop you. But you are trying to write to repository, and meanwhile, after the point that you have read and the point at which you are writing, in between somebody wrote that, somebody modified that file. So which means the file which you have read is an old one. So you will get an error called out of date. And what subversion does is, it doesn't give any problem to you. It says you better read again. And when you read it, the changes from others also will come into your local system along with your changes. This is called merging. Your changes and other changes will reside now. This is called merging. So copy, you take a copy, you modify, you make your work. But after you copy and before you send to server, if somebody else modified, you will not be allowed. Your file is outdated. So you will read again. So when you read again, you will get the changes from others into your system, which is nothing but your changes and other changes will be together in your system. This is called merge. And now you are allowed to write back to repository. This solution is called as copy, modify and merge in subversion. So this is how subversion allows multiple team members to read at any point of time, to make changes and write back to repository using this principle. This is how subversion allows team collaboration between multiple team members of the project. So whenever any change happens to a file, to the repository, there is a concept in subversion called revision. Revision is a global property. In a repository, there can be multiple projects. And if you make a change to any file in any project, the revision number will be incremented by 1. When you create repository, the revision number is 1. There are 10 projects. So you keep changing in 10 projects. Every time you make a change, revision number will be 2, revision number will be 3. So if it is with this revision number, your repository knows whether the state is changed or not. Okay. So now you understood 3 technical words. One is repository, one is working copy, one is revision number. These 3 are important keywords in subversion. Now what we will do is, whatever you have learned now, how do you take a copy, how do you modify, how do you send your changes to repository, when will you get the out of date error, and in case if you get out of date error, what will you do? Okay, so all these things now we'll try to implement in our own terms so that you will understand the concept much better. I am creating one folder, say batch 25. Now, the first thing that we need to do is, you know, copy, right? So we have created a repository a while ago. We need to, so in the repository, you have branches, you have tags, you have trunk. At this point, remember that trunk is where the development happens. All the developers will be working in trunk for the development phase. So now what I do, I need to take a copy of trunk in my system. So I will right click on trunk in Visual SVN server. I will say copy URL to clipboard. Now here I will, if you have installed Tortoise in your machine, if you right click, you will see something like SVN checkout. So here I have batch 25 slash trunk. This is what I need to. The repository contents are referred by the URL, and into the copy batch 25, let me name it as trunk. So let me take a checkout of this. So I have trunk created here, but I don't have any files. Naturally, I just created an empty repository with a default structure, but I don't have any files. So what I am going to do now is I will add some files to the repository. I am a developer, I just joined today. So I will add couple of files. I'm just creating a dummy file. So I'm just started. Just imagine I'm a developer. I'm making some changes to source code. Okay. I will add a folder as well. Okay, so what I have done now is I have written some content. I have written some source code. I have implemented a feature, say for instance. Okay. Now, if you have all seen here, you will see a question mark symbol here. So what does it mean? It means that It means that you will see the question mark symbol here. The question mark symbol indicates that there are some files in subversion here, but subversion is not recognizing them. That is because you have not added them. So the first thing whenever there is a new file is that you need to add it to subversion. Tortoise SVN, you will have a symbol here, add. Click on that. So if you say that, your files will get added. So what it means is, now subversion knows that there are certain files getting added. Now next time when you send your changes to repository, these files will be added to repository as well. The add operation is only client, just keeping it ready for commit. Whenever you say commit, along with other changes, the added files also will be added to the repository. Okay. So now what I do, there are no other changes for me. I will send these two files to the repository. Okay. Whenever you have a new file, you have to add it and then you have to send the changes to the repository. How do you send changes to repository? Taking the copy from repository into your system is called checkout. That is what we have done little before. SVN checkout. SVN checkout will check out the contents from repository into your system. Now reverse. From your system you are sending changes to repository. It is called check-in. It is also called commit. So what I am doing now is SVN commit. So whenever you have to commit, you have to give a message, added, give a meaningful message, added to new files in subversion. You can see that now the symbol moved from plus to green. Green indicates that there are no changes left, local modifications in your copy. Things are in sync with your repository. Okay. There are no more changes that you need to send to your So there are no more changes that you need to send to your repository from your system. That is the meaning of this green. Now let me make some more changes. Started with task 2 today. So there is some change happening here. Okay, I'm committing it. So whenever you make a change, you will see red symbol. Red symbol indicates that it is a local modification. Plus indicates it is a new file. Green indicates that it is already committed to the repository. Now I made a small change. Again, I will commit. Committed. Okay, I make one more change. You will see the red symbol here. You will make the commit. So what we have seen just now is how do you take a checkout, how do you add a file, and how do you make changes to a file, and how do you commit your changes to the repository. So the scenario that I am going to explain you now is there is a developer in US. These are two folders in my system, but understand them as one is in Indian laptop, another one is in US laptop. Okay, there is a developer in US and developer in India. First, the developer in US have joined. So he took the checkout of the, he took the URL of the trunk, SVN checkout. He is taking trunk checkout into his system. Yes, he has got all the files. Okay, so developer US joined the company. So first thing, if you want to work on the project, you should get the SVN URL. So that he will take the copy into his system, then he will start making his changes. Similarly, developer India also joined. So he will also need to have the SVN checkout into his system. He also needs the URL of the trunk. He took the checkout into his system. It's also available. Now the scenario is that both developer India is having the work with, have the checkout with him where he can work on the project. Developer in US also has the checkout with him. He can also work on the project. Now the developer in US has started working. Fix a bug. Okay. In task 1. So he is fixing a bug. I'll just put here who is making that change for your better understanding. So developer US is making this change. Here's a red symbol here. If you want to see precisely what did this guy modify, right click authorize SVN, just click on diff. Diff will give the change that this file has compared to the original version. This plus line indicates the line that is added. Fix a bug in task 1. This is what equal to you can ignore. This is notepad issue. This is not the change. The plus line is the change. Changes will be with plus and minus. Those are the changes which are added and which are removed respectively. Here they have, I have not removed anything. I have a plus symbol which indicates I have added a line. Fix a bug in task 1 by developer US. This is the line that he has done. Okay. Now he is making this change. Similarly, let's imagine the developer India is also making the change. So he started with task 1 today. So continue on it. This is developer India. So if you see what this guy is working on today, same in developer India, on that file I am just clicking on diff so that I am just seeing what did this guy change. So in second line he is making some change. He is saying that he is continuing on it on some task. Okay, good. So both of them have made the modifications. Both of them have taken the checkout. Okay, both of them have made their modifications. Now just imagine that the US guy got the opportunity to commit. Okay, first this guy is writing, now he is making the commit, made some changes to the task 2, task 1, whatever it is. He has committed it. Okay, done. Now our Indian resource doesn't know this fact that that file is modified. So without that knowledge, he is also going and committing it. So what will happen now? It will stop because this src file.1.txt has been modified by the resource from US after he has read. So that file is modified in server, but this guy don't know that fact. So the file which he has read is an old one. There is a new version of file in repository now. So this guy is not allowed. So it says the file is out of date. This item is out of date. And it also says you have to update your working copy. Take an update. That's what it says. That take an update is called read again. And I say read again, it's also technically called in subversion as take an update. Okay. So it's asking update the working copy and then reopen the commit dialog. Yes, update the working copy. You can see here merged. You can see here merged. So what we have seen here is you took a copy, you made your modification, but when you attempted to commit, there was an out of date error because somebody else made a change to that file without your knowledge. So it asked you to read again, and when you read again, it brought the changes from others into your system. So let's see. I'll just cancel it and commit again. Now if you see the diff, now you are in India, remember? There was a change done by US, and let's see if you have got that change. You can see this is the line which US guy has committed. Fixed a bug in task 1 by developer US. Then I am going to commit now. Because I tried to US developer, Indian developer have started working. First thing they did, they took checkout. Second thing they did, they modified their files. Next, the one from US got the opportunity to commit first. He is allowed, he is committed. So the file state is modified. So, and the Indian developer doesn't know that doesn't know that fact. So he is trying to send his change also to the server. So subversion has stopped him, saying you cannot commit now. So what it also suggested him is read again, so that the changes done by others also come into your system. And when he tried to read again, the changes are brought into his system. The change done by developer news is brought into here, along with his change, what he has done. Now he is allowed to commit. You can see every time I make a commit, the revision number just gets incremented by 1. This is how subversion is able to identify what happened at each revision, which files are modified and so on. Devrat Pandya came to his office. The first thing that he will do is take an SVN update. In that way, changes done by others will be into his system. Developer Nuyas also came to office. He took an SVN update. In that way, changes done by others will be in his system. So the both of them have the latest code base, which is in synchronization with the repository. Update will bring changes from repository into the working copy. First time you call it checkout, next time onwards you call it update. The process of bringing in the changes from the repository into your working copy, first time is called checkout, next time onwards it is called update, technically in subversion. So Developer India brought the latest changes from repository into his system. Developer India brought it, Developer News brought it. So Developer India is making a change. So in the seventh line, Developer India made a change in line 7. Similarly, Developer US, Developer US is making a change in line 7. You can see here 7 here and just line 7. Now both of them have made the change at the same line. Hypothetical situation, but nevertheless we should understand all the possible scenarios. Okay, so both of them have completed their work. Now Developer US got the chance to commit. He is the first one who is making the change commit, right? He is allowed to make a change. Done. Okay, he has done it. Now Developer India doesn't know that. He is also trying to commit. Naturally, he will be stopped, right? Because somebody else did modification, he doesn't know that fact, he is trying to commit. He is stopped. Okay? So what will he do? He needs to take an update now. Then only he will get the changes from USK into his system. Then he can commit. So it's asking for update. Okay, update. But here there is a problem. It says conflicted. What is this conflicted? This is conflicting because SVN is in a trouble now. SVN doesn't know anything to do at this point because at line 7 there is a change coming from USGI from your repository, and at line 7 Developer India also made a change. Here if I allow the repository content, my changes are lost. If I allow your change, my changes to be retained, changes from server are lost. In this case SVN doesn't help anything. In this case, configuration engineer can help. How does he do it? Click on OK. So right click on this file. This symbol indicates that the file is in conflict. These are the various options which SVN is suggesting. If I take the work from others, what will it be? If I take the work from mine alone, how will it be like that? You don't worry about all those things. Just focus on your conflicted file. Tortoise SVN, you have an option called Edit Conflicts. Now you can see that there are two lines in red. The two lines in red, indicates the conflicts. This line is same. So for this line, you can say use this text block. There is not a problem there, but this line you see, there is a problem in line 7. Developer US made a change here. Developer India made a change here. So what are the various options that you have? Option 1. I can choose this text block. But if I choose this, this content will be here. The contents of Indian guy are lost. See, mine indicates where am I presently, in which folder. I am in India, right? So mine indicates India here. Theirs indicates change from US. Okay? So if I retain this, use this text block, this line is lost. If I say this, use this text block, this line is lost. Alternatively, I can say use the text block from mine before days. So put my code before their code. So if I choose that one, you can see my code is placed here before their code. Okay, this is how you resolve the conflict. Save it and click resolve. Okay, now you will see it. This file has all those extra files got deleted, and this file moved from conflict state into modified state. Now if you see the diff, you will see that the change, this is your change, developer India, you are making a change, and the line change done by developer US in line 7 is also brought into your code. Now you are making the commit. Okay. Okay, this is how you, when multiple people are making changes to the same line, you will get problems. When multiple people are making changes to the same file, you may get problems with conflicts. And this is how you resolve the conflicts and proceed in your day-to-day activities as a developer. To achieve your first goal in subversion, team collaboration, effective team collaboration. Now multiple team members can have a copy of the source code in their system. They can make their changes, they can send their changes, but if their files are outdated, they will be asked to update, and when they are taking update, sometimes they get conflicts. And if they get conflicts, they can resolve the conflicts in an easy manner and send their changes into the SVN repository. This is how multiple team members from multiple geographic locations can share their work with each other without losing each other's work. This concludes our session 1. This is my website, codingbasics.blogspot.com. Where you have lot of, this is purely written with the perspective of consultants in this domain, build and release domain. So you have lot of fundamentals here. You have SVN basics, interview questions, branches and merging. So all the things are available here. Just in case, you can follow this one as well for your. When you are free, you want to learn other things also, you can go ahead and learn.